All right, well, hey, good morning, Harvest. Good to be with you all this morning. Let's stand to our feet. For those who don't know me, my name is Flav Herlow. I'm the central worship leader here. And before we get started today, I just want to introduce you to a couple friends. You might know them. We have Rochelle and Kyle with us this morning. Guys, so glad you're here. They're good friends and church family, so we're just glad that they're here this morning. Church, as we prepare our hearts to worship, Psalm 150 encourages us to praise the Lord, right? Regardless of what your beliefs are in whatever political party or wherever you were born or whatever, anything. If you have breath in your lungs, you're encouraged to praise the Lord. He is good, He is faithful, and He is here with us this morning. So come on, church, join us as we praise and worship the Lord this morning. Here we go.
I'm not afraid to die.
can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You're an almighty fortress, and you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. Nothing.
Amazing. It's awesome that we serve a Lord who provides. Amen? Yeah. Amen. Do you believe that? Yes. And that's why we seek him. That's why we ask, because he is our provider. Man, our church has been in this 40 days of prayer, and I really sense that our hearts towards prayer have become more fervent. And it's amazing to see that. It's also amazing to see that we are seeking the Lord in the right posture of not necessarily seeking for things to get, because the thing that we get is him in the seeking, right? God loves to hear from us. He loves to be in communion with us, and prayer gives an opportunity to do that. So I hope that you've been blessed by this over the last 40 days. It's been amazing to see the answered prayers too over the last 40 days. We have someone who had prayed that they would be cancer free, and they are cancer free. It's amazing. Several people have been praying for jobs, and we can confirm that a few of them have received those jobs. But I think my favorite one is for the one brother who was praying for a family member that they would just attend church. How many of us have that prayer in the room, right? He had been praying for this for a long time, and not only did this family member come to church last week, but they surrendered their life as well. And that's why we pray for that, right? If we could just get them to church, God will do the rest. Amen? But I don't want to discount the fact that there are those who are still seeking the Lord, right? And there are those who are in the room this morning with fresh petitions. And so what we get to do as a family is come alongside one another. That's why we gather together. It says, don't neglect to gather together. Especially all the more as you see the day drawing near, because as we gather together, we encourage one another. And so right now, we're going to get an opportunity to do that. We're going to spend some time in prayer together. So I want to encourage you to grab maybe 2, 3, maybe up to 5 people and just pray in a moment. But if you don't feel comfortable doing that, then just pray on your own. But let's go before the Lord together and continue to seek him for the things that we need. Amen? Amen.
working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you work. Even when I don't feel it, you working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Just your voice as we sing. Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Yes, God.
faced his heart firm upon man, knowing the cause before he began. Who gave himself when all things went near? Oh, God is here. It's here. So we cry.
Once again, as we sing Christ crucified and raised to life again, and you invite us into that life with you. So thank you. Hear these songs as an earnest and loud thank you, God. And the way that we sing them even be a sign of our faith placed in them and the realities they're in. Lord, we love you. What a joy it is to call out to you in prayer and put our trust in you there, and to sing songs that will remind us on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, of your goodness. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. We pray all of these things in thankful prayer to the name above every name, the name of Jesus Christ. Everyone said, amen, amen, amen. Amen. It's good to sing together. Amen. Amen. It's also good to just be together. So as we continue in our worship, why don't you just like find somebody you didn't come to church with, just greet them in the Lord, and then you can be seated.
Good morning. Woo. It's so good to be at church this morning. Amen. God is good. Well, welcome to Harvest. My name is Stephanie Geisler. I'm the Central Women's Director, and it's so good to be with you guys this morning. If this is your first time, special welcome to you. Glad you decided to check out Harvest today. I'd love to meet you. I'll be in the lobby after service. I'd love to help you get connected here at the church. For everyone here, we want to make sure you're plugged into the life of the church. We don't want you just to attend on Sunday. We want to make sure you feel known, that you feel loved here at church. And one of the ways we do that is knowing how we can care for you through prayer and knowing that you're here. So right now, pull out your phone and open the Harvest Bible Chapel app on Church Center. If you don't have the app, you can find it in the App Store, or you can find it on the QR code on the back of the seat in front of you. So let us know you're here today, and also send us a prayer request. The way we know a lot of the prayers were answered throughout this prayer series is because people were presenting these prayer requests over and over, and we got to see the praise come in. We got to see how God was answering prayers, and we got to pray with people. So make sure you let us know how we can be praying for you throughout the week. Speaking of prayer, next Friday night is our women's all-campus worship and prayer night. It is going to be awesome. We are focusing on restoration, and it will be Friday night from 7 to 9:30 here at the Meadows campus. We're going to worship. We're going to pray. We're going to talk about what it means to be restored in the Lord. So don't miss out. If you've been to any of our women's worship nights, you know that God moves in such a mighty way. Bring a friend, invite your family. We're so excited to seek the Lord together as a women's ministry. So make sure you come on Friday. We always pray for another like-minded church, and this week we're praying for the Heights in Arlington Heights and Pastor Jason Akers. That name may sound familiar. He used to be the pastor at the North Shore campus, and then he went to City Line and is planting a church out of City Line Bible Church. So it's so cool to see how God is multiplying the church, right? And planting other gospel-believing churches in Arlington Heights. And so we're praying for God to move in a mighty way through the Heights. And they're praying for their finances for a church. They're praying for their community to be a light in their community. And just for the families in that church to grow in their love for the Lord. So we're going to pray for Pastor Jason and Terry and for their church in just a moment. But before that, we want to be able to enter into a time of giving. Matthew 6, 19 through 21 says, "Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasure in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." And we hear this verse so often, but a lot of times we forget what this truly means. Is that we don't need to be focused on the temporary things of this world. We need to be focused on kingdom things, on heavenly things, and focus on giving our adoration to the Lord through our giving. Giving is an act of surrender, trusting that God is sovereign over all of our finances, all the things in our life, and so we get to worship him through our giving. So there are several ways listed to give listed on the screen, and so take time today or throughout the week to be able to give to the Lord, because he deserves the first fruits of our lives, because he's our provider, just like we talked about earlier. So let's pray together over our offering and over Pastor Jason and for our service together. Lord, you are holy. There is none like you. We thank you that we can sing to you, that we can come into your presence. And Lord, you hear our prayers. We thank you for Jesus Christ, that he was crucified and raised to life and invites us into a resurrected life through him. Lord, we thank you for the truth of the gospel, that it reveals your character, that you loved us so much that you sent your only son to save us. So Lord, I pray that we don't lose our awe of you this morning. We thank you for what you're already doing in our hearts and minds this morning. And Lord, I pray for Pastor Jason and the Heights. Lord, I thank you for them planting a new church in Arlington Heights. Lord, establish the work of their hands. Lord, we ask that your Holy Spirit just moves in every decision they make, in every single detail that they're working through as they're planting. Lord, I pray that you would just have your way in them. Lord, I pray for their finances, that, Lord, you provide for them. I pray that there are a light in their community, and I pray for the families at that church that they would grow in their love and knowledge of you. And Lord, protect Jason and Terry. May they be able to continue and be steadfast in the things you've called them to. And Lord, I pray for our offerings to you. That, Lord, I pray that we would not give out of compulsion or out of obligation, but Lord, may we give out of our love for you. So Lord, show us where we have been stingy in our love for you. Show us where our affections have not been turned to you. So Lord, I pray that you would help us to give because we love you and we know you've been so generous to us. Lord, bless these gifts, that Lord, it'd be used to further your kingdom. It would be used to further ministry, to bless those in need, and to help continue the ministry of our church. And Lord, I pray for our service today, that God, you would continue to transform our hearts, that Lord, we would desire to know you and to pray and to have a deeper walk with you. So Lord, I pray you'd be with Pastor Jeff, that you would fill him afresh with your spirit, and Lord, you speak through him today. Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you for who you are. May your will be done. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, grab your Bibles as we're about to dive into the teaching. We got the pain just to make it today. I said we pray. Oh yeah, we pray.
We got the pain just to make it today. How are you? Yeah, it's nice to see you. It's great to have you. Look, if you have a Bible, I want to invite you to open it to Romans, the book of Romans, chapter 12. One verse today. Romans 12, 12. This is the last sermon in our series on prayer that we titled A.S.K. And that's an acronym for ask, seek, and knock. It just happens to also work out to be the same as the first word in that. I don't know if you have ever had the opportunity to look at an executive summary before. I didn't even know these things existed for a long time in my life. I used to think that if you became really important in a business or whatever, the hardest part would be that you had to actually read through all of the reports and things that people would give you. But I came to realize, as some of my friends rose through the ranks in their businesses, that when you reach the pinnacle of the authority in a particular company, especially a big one, the people who are writing the reports will usually write a first, like, summary paragraph so that you don't have to read the entire thing, which I always think is funny because you have to write the whole thing, but you have to give them the little Cliff's Notes versions. I don't know if that's because the people who are in charge of all the businesses are lazy or they just have so many things to look at, but the executive summary is a remarkable thing. I actually think that most books should have an executive summary. That way I could save some of my time. Some books are, you know, hundreds and hundreds of pages long, and as you're reading through them, you're like, this is actually just an executive summary with a whole bunch of examples or illustrations. But the idea of an executive summary is a good one. Wouldn't it be great for people, or for you to have somebody around you who could summarize the concept or the idea that somebody's trying to get across to you? I hate Excel. I think that Microsoft Excel is a tool of the devil. And if somebody puts an Excel spreadsheet in front of me, my eyes glaze over and I start thinking about Hawaii and stuff. So what I need is the accountant or whatever geek has put together the Excel spreadsheet. I need them to tell me, okay, so what are the guts of this? Like, what exactly is this trying to tell me? And then they'll give me bullet points of three or four particular things. And I'm saying, was that hard? You could have done that in Word.
What is the executive summary for the Christian life? So you come to faith in Jesus. To be a Christian is pretty straightforward, right? You have to admit that you don't have it together, that you have not made the best of your life, that essentially you have sinned against God and against others. And if you were to stand before God today, that you would stand before him as guilty. But Jesus, who is righteous, is willing to make a trade with you. He's willing to say, because I died in your place, I'm willing to give you my righteous life. I died the death you should have died as a judgment for your sins, but I lived the life you should have lived, and I'm willing to take your punishment for the sin and give you my righteous life, not based on anything you do. You don't need to, like, you know, meet up to some standard. All you have to do is to say, I need it. Have mercy on me, a sinner. And then you come to faith in Christ, and you say, I'm going to follow you now the rest of my days on earth, or I can spend the rest of eternity with you in the joy of your Father. But what does that look like to follow him the rest of the days on earth? Now, look, most of the Bible is about that. Most of the New Testament is about, well, what does it look like for you to follow Jesus? But if we were going to summarize it in bullet points, what would we say? I actually think that there's this little verse in Romans that does this. That if you want the quick executive summary version of what the Christian life is, what are you supposed to do between now and the time that you die or Jesus returns in order to be a faithful Christian? What does it look like? There's more to say than an executive summary, but what are the guts of it? And I think that this little passage in Romans 12, verse 12, does really well. Three things. One, rejoice in hope. Two, be patient in affliction. And three, be persistent in prayer. Rejoice in hope, be patient in affliction, and be persistent in prayer. This is a pastor's dream, by the way, this little verse, right? I don't know how any guy comes by this passage and doesn't say, I'm going to preach a sermon on that one verse. Because it's 3 points. Look, he just gives them to you. You don't have to do a whole lot. So, because I'm lazy, we're going to do this passage. Actually, this is one of the great little passages in the book of Romans that is going to explain a lot, actually, about what Paul has to say in Romans and what the book's about. But ultimately, where it's going to lead is going to show us how central prayer is to the operation of the Christian life. And it's going to serve kind of as our capstone to our series. So, like I said, 3 phrases ultimately leading to the certainty or the centrality of prayer. So, let's deal with them in order. Rejoice in hope is the first. What do we mean by this word, hope? When the Apostle Paul talks about hope in the book of Romans, what is he talking about? There are a lot of passages, quite honestly, in the book of Romans dealing with hope, but almost all of them basically are a description of what it is that you have to look forward to. As a Christian, what do you have to look forward to? You ever sat down with your kids or a friend who's having a hard time in a present moment, and you say, but you've got a lot to look forward to. I was in Dallas this last week with my son. I had a chance to go down to see him. My middle son is playing baseball at Dallas Baptist University, and he transferred there so that he could be a starting pitcher there as opposed to a reliever where he was at Louisiana State University. And so he's, you know, it's his draft year that's coming up this year, and so Things are great. He's been dating his girlfriend for 4 years, long distance. They are getting married in December. And so, yeah, it's cool, right? So there's an end coming to this long distance dating relationship, but you know, he's reached the point of senioritis where he's like, I'm so sick of this. I just want to get married to her and have her move to be with me. So I, you know, you sit down with your kid when you go and visit them at college and they start kind of unloading on you because you're a safe place, and they unload on you regarding all the challenges that they're having in all of their life and how difficult it is. He's got an English class that's driving him crazy because the English teacher doesn't grade like he wants. And he's like, I can't get her to see that I'm doing what she's telling me to do. He's even been online and seen the reviews of her, and they're not good. And he's like, see, I knew I wasn't alone, you know. So he's got all of these challenges in front of him. And he said, I'm just so tired. I've been playing baseball since last January, and I pitched so much, and it's been in three different locations, and I'm just exhausted. Just need a break. I just need this break. And so he's down. And I remember we just sat across the table from him eating Tex-Mex, which is what God gives us to sustain us. If you don't know that, then you should eat more Tex-Mex. And I said to him, what you say to your kid? But Micah, you have a lot to look forward to. Like, seriously, man, in a couple weeks, you know, his fiance is going to come and she's going to visit. And then right after that, you're going to come back to Chicago and you're going to have Thanksgiving with us. And then like a couple weeks after that, you're going to go back to British Columbia and you're going to get ready for your wedding, which will happen a week later, and we'll all be there to celebrate this wedding. And then you have Christmas, and then you're going to the Bahamas for your honeymoon. Right? And then she moves to Dallas with you. You start your lives out, and the baseball season comes around, and which you've been waiting for a long time to start for this team, and you're going to be one of their key guys, and then you'll be playing, and eventually next July, Lord willing, you'll finish, and you'll be up for the draft, and you might be drafted into Major League Baseball. Brother, just you've got so much to look forward to. And the reason you tell your kids this, or your friend this, or your spouse this, is so that they can see their present suffering moment in light of actually the wider framework. You're taking up to 30,000 foot view and saying, but don't you realize, I know it feels like you're in the middle of the woods right here, but you have no idea. Just a few more steps and you're going to be into just the magnificent beach and it's going to be beautiful. You're trying to place them and their situation in a wider context. You have a lot to look forward to. So what do you have to look forward to, Christian? A lot. A lot more than you could even imagine. In fact, if you did imagine it, the response that would happen to you would be you'd rejoice. The reason that you're not rejoicing is either that you don't understand how grand it is, or you just don't think about it enough. And you and I, we get so stuck in this little moment, and we think, oh my goodness, this is going to be so bad. How will this ever end? But man, it ends, and we win. So when Paul's using this language of hope, he's building on language that he's used throughout the book. So Romans 5, he says, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So what happens when you come to faith in Jesus is that you are justified. That means that you stand righteous before him. That means that God does not look at you as not guilty. He looks at you as righteous. It's different. You were very guilty. He doesn't just like wipe it away and say, all right, now you're on an even slate. You get to work yourself into positive or negative. We'll see. No, he actually, the language is, he imputes the righteousness of Jesus onto you. He says, whatever goodness Jesus has is what you have. And because of that, and because Jesus was ultimately just, you are just, justified. And every reward that Jesus got for the obedience to the Father is now yours. Since we've been justified by faith, not by anything we did, but simply by belief in the Lord Jesus and what he did for us, We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, through Jesus, we have also, not just do we have peace, we've also obtained access by faith into this grace in which we stand. We stand before God in a state of grace, not a state of judgment or condemnation, in a state of grace. And when it comes to the future, we rejoice in hope. So use the language, same language. We rejoice in hope of what? The glory of God. What is he referring to now? The hope of the glory of God. What are we talking about? All right, so a couple chapters later, he gets into it again. He says, I consider that the sufferings of this present time, your situation in the present moment, right in the middle of the woods, Micah, in this moment that you're in right now, I don't consider the sufferings of this present time are worth comparing with the glory, there's the language, that is to be revealed to us. And I want to know more about this glory, Paul. Talk to me. All right. Four, let me give you some explanation here. The creation, so let's look at the world around, the dirt and the trees and the sky and the birds. The creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. So when you step on the dirt outside and if it were able to scream, which it can't, but if it were able to scream, it would say, I can't wait for you to be revealed as the true Son of God you are, Christian. The creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage. The reason it's screaming at you and saying, I can't wait, is because the creation is in bondage just like you and I are in bondage. And when you and I are set free, when I say you and I, I'm referring to Christian people, right? I'm saying when you and I are set free from the bondage of this mortal body and we put on the immortal body, the resurrection body, then all creation will follow suit, and it will be freed. Be set free from his bondage to his corruption and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth. Remember this word, these words. Been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit, meaning that we have a promise from God in his Spirit that this is actually going to happen, that we're going to get full redemption and a resurrection body. We groan inwardly. Amen? As we wait, just like the creation and the dirt waits, we groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for the adoption as sons, the redemption of our body. So what happened to Jesus when he gets his resurrection body, we get a resurrection body like his. In this hope, we were saved. What hope? The redemption of our bodies. The Christian hope is that one day all of the pain and heartache that you experience because you inhabit this body that is so fallen will be no more. That pain and sorrow and heartache. You have no idea. The entire left side of my body is awful. I have a toe that was broken years ago that didn't get fixed. I've got a broken leg that still hurts. I have a meniscus tear that keeps tearing. I've got a hip. I don't know what's wrong with my hip. It just hurts all the time. I've got a stent in my heart, and I've got a brain that malfunctions and makes me think that I'm crazy. I have to go to doctors, and they're like, no, you're crazy. And I groan for the redemption of my body. And the universe groans in its rampant. You realize what I'm telling you? I'm telling you that it's not just your feelings about your own personal thing. I'm saying that every beautiful thing that you see outside the doors of our church or anywhere, you go to the mountains, you look at a river, you look at the fall colors, picture the most beautiful thing that you know of in the created order. It is under a curse. You look at the trees and you see the browns and the yellows and the reds, and you see the sun streaming through it on the fall, crisp fall day like this, and you say, what magnificent beauty. Brothers and sisters, it's cursed. Can you imagine the color spectrum in the non-cursed version? Can you imagine what you will see and the beauty of the mountains and the mist coming across the sea? Can you imagine just the majesty of the non-cursed new heaven and new earth? And you will be there in your renewed body. We rejoice because our hope is in a heavenly future. You know, when I say that phrase, I want to make sure you understand. We are not, the heavenly future for a Christian is not in some disembodied mystical paradise somewhere. Okay? There's an old cartoon by a guy named Gary Larson. When I was a kid, he was my favorite cartoonist. He was weird, but very funny. And the cartoon is a single panel cartoon, and in it, it has a picture of a guy with a harp, and he's on a cloud, and he's obviously in heaven, and he's got his halo, and he's sitting there looking bored, and on the bottom it says, I wish I would have brought a magazine. Because that's the way lots of people understand heaven. Well, what's going to happen? Well, I'm going to be lifted out of this body, and I'm going to go up to some ethereal, mystical world that is filled with clouds, and nothing could be further from the truth. The Christian hope is the renewed physical earth, the renewed physical heavens, with a renewed physical body, the same that Jesus had when he rose from the dead. And it's physical. I know that because when Thomas comes up to him and says, I'm not going to believe unless I touch his side and his hands. Jesus shows up and says, have a touch, Thomas. And Thomas touches him. He doesn't reach through him like he's some sort of weird ghost. He touches him. Which means that all of the great things that you and I experience in the present time, right? A great soccer game, a great beauty that we see outside, all of the things that we do that gives us joy, sailing, work. I know that's hard to believe, but can imagine when work is redeemed. The sports are redeemed. There's no more Bears. I'm kidding. Right? Imagine though, when that takes place, that's what it will be like. Randy Alcorn in his outstanding book Heaven, which you should read, because it's going to give you joy in your heavenly future. You have a lot to look forward to. He said that my wife and I have spent some wonderful moments with our family and friends at Christmas or on vacation or at simple times in the family room after dinner, and we said those enchanting words. It can't get any better than this. No matter how difficult your life's been, you said the same thing about some magnificent moment, haven't you? Maybe it was recently. Maybe it was long ago. Maybe you can barely remember. It doesn't get any better than this. Can you think of even once in your life when even for a moment that seemed to be true? Well, it isn't true. The most ordinary moment on the new earth will be greater than the most perfect moments in this life. Those experiences you wanted to bottle or hang on to because you couldn't, it can get better. It will get far better than this. Life on the new earth will be like sitting in front of the fire with family and friends, basking in the warmth, laughing uproariously, dreaming of the adventures to come, and then going out and living those adventures together with no fear that life will ever end or that tragedy will descend like a dark cloud, with no fear that dreams will be shattered or that life will, or that relationships will be broken. We were all made for a person and a place. Jesus is that person and heaven is that place. I had a friend, this occurred to me for the first time in my Christian life when I was quite a young Christian. I was working at a Christian camp, and I remember I was talking to the other counselor in the cabin, and his name was Dan, and he'd been a Christian a lot longer than I had, and so he started talking to me about heaven and what the Bible taught about heaven, and I was like, kind of like, whoa, that's fascinating. He's like, it's going to be magnificent. He was describing it to me kind of in academic terms, and I was like, okay. And I remember talking for a good hour about these things. I was peppering him with questions. We eventually had to go, and we had dinner. We went to the dining hall, and I was sitting there at dinner. I didn't remember what I was eating, but I remember sitting there at the table, and it just struck me. It was one of those moments of epiphany where the Lord just said, you do realize what he was talking about, right? And he kind of shoved it in my heart, and I realized, oh, my word. If what he's saying is true, that I'm going to heaven, and heaven's going to be like I just described it here. If heaven's going to be like that, oh, my word. Oh, my word. My face lit up. Guys at the table were like, what's going on with you? And I was like, dude, we're going to heaven. And they're like, I know. Do you, though? Do you know? Yeah. But you don't know, right? Because you complain all the time. Why are you complaining all the time? What are you talking about? It's heaven. Oh, my word. I was super excited. Anyway, after dinner, I walked down the way, and Dan, the guy who explained to me, came to me, and he came to me, and I was like, and he said, what's wrong with you? And I said, what's wrong with you? Don't you realize where we're going? What's going on? Okay, so I have a question for you. What if you don't feel that kind of joy all the time? Are you sinning? Like, is it wrong not to be happy as a Christian? And by happy, I mean like, I'm going to heaven. And the answer is, I don't think it's a sin. You know why? Because of what this passage says, right here. We know that the whole creation has been groaning together in the pains of childbirth until now. The image is pretty clear. So he's saying, look, there's a baby coming, and, you know, the baby is going to be the new heavens and new earth, and it's the redemption of our bodies. But in the meantime, as we're in the present moment, we're like a woman who's in labor. Have you ever spent any time around women in labor? How many of them have you said have been going like, I'm having a baby, look at me. If you're a husband here, or your wife's about to give birth, piece of advice, when she starts screaming, don't put your hand on her and go, what's wrong, honey? Why aren't you happier? There's a baby coming. We already gave it a name. Stop crying. Toughen up. Say these things and you won't see the baby. Of course you don't approach it that way. You know that she's in the midst of this pain and heartache in the present moment, but she's got a lot to look forward to. And the reason that she's willing to go through all the pain and the heartache is because she's got a lot to look forward to. She hopes for the birth of a child, but she groans until it comes. This is our plight. So our rejoicing is not like a plastic happiness, but it is a settled confidence that it won't always be like this. We have a lot to look forward to. So rejoice in hope. And be patient in affliction. You can see how they're tied together, right? Like, if you're going to rejoice in hope, it's going to mean, okay, this hope is going to have to give some perspective on the affliction. What kind of perspective? Well, it's going to lead to you being patient. That language of be patient in affliction. This word here, to be patient, is a word that by most Greek commentaries means something to the effect of maintaining a course of action in the face of opposition. Maintaining a course of action in the face of opposition. It is a word that means perseverance. Other translations actually go this way. They say persevere in affliction, persevere in suffering. Continue, even though everything is against you, continue down the path. You and I love the idea of perseverance. We really do. It is actually a cultural value for us. And for me as a father, it is a fatherly value for me to pass on to my children that perseverance is a thing. I have told my kids since they were very young, it doesn't matter if you fall, it matters if you get back up. It matters if you get back up. And I've been so proud. The proudest moments I've had as a father is when my kids actually have done this. Remember the time when my son Mike was playing first base in baseball, and the left-handed hitter just rocketed a ball right off the dirt, and it took a bad hop and hit him straight in the face. Right? Blood everywhere. His eye was already starting to swell. He was on there. He's like 9 years old, and he's on the ground, writhing in pain. All the coaches are coming around. Are you okay? The people are saying, he needs to come out. He probably got a concussion. And so I walked around to the side, and I was like, are you? I didn't get on the field. I said, are you okay? And he goes, shh. And he pushed himself off the ground, and he stood up, and he says, I'm staying in. Right? And his coaches are like, no, you're not. And I'm like, yeah, let the boy cook. You know, like, I'm like, come on. That's my kid. He hit a double later in the game with like one eye, you know, nailed his double. I'm like, yeah, it's my kid with one eye, you know. That's right. My eldest son, Ethan, he actually told you before that he did the trust fall and I dropped him and he broke his arm, right? Okay, another story. Come back later if you want to hear about that. But he broke his arm and he was on a baseball team that I was coaching at the time. And so he was like, what am I going to do about baseball? I said, you're still going to play? What do you tell you? You got another arm, right? And he's like, okay. So I got him the different glove for the arm that he needed. And so he would catch the ball, and then he would put the ball in his other hand, his broken hand, and with the cast on. And he'd throw the glove down, and he'd throw the ball in, okay? He was still better than all the other kids. We were in the playoffs, and I was like, we were at a point where I needed somebody to get a hit because our team was terrible, and we weren't getting a hit. And I said, Ethan, you're in. And he's got one arm. And he's like, how do I hit? I don't know. Just get up there and hit the ball. I don't care. Right? And he did. He got on base, hit a ground ball. He went to first base. And I'm like, that's my kid, my one-armed kid. Ah, keep going, son. Right? Now, look, I don't know why that's become such a value for me. You need to know a little bit about New Zealand culture, which really got inside of me in the years that I was there. I broke my nose in New Zealand when I was playing ultimate frisbee. The frisbee came up here, and I came down and whacked my nose and blood everywhere. And I'm alone on the ground, and I'm moaning, you know. You know, and I'm dizzy, I got a concussion, and I'm on the ground in a pool of my own blood. And this New Zealand friend of mine, he's the only guy who even paid attention to me, he came over and he goes, get up, you whinging American. Right? Because he was like, you're complaining too much. You're embarrassing yourself. Just get up. It's a rugby culture. They're like, we've all broken our noses. Just get up. You know? To go and have reconstructive surgery on my face. And he was like, ah, toughen up, mate. Maybe it's because I lived in Canada. In Canada, they make fun of soccer players a lot. Because, you know, like, oh, you touched me. I'm down. But it's a hockey culture, and they're like, you know what? If you're not missing teeth, you're not playing. You deliver the hit, you take the hit, you keep going. And we love the movies like this, don't we? Rudy, Rudy, Rudy. Can't make it into Notre Dame, but he keeps going. He goes to the community college, and then he keeps showing up, and he's finally gets to the end, and he rushes around the end. He was offside, but he rushes around the end, and he gets to the bag, and he tackles, and they lift him up, and Rudy, and honestly, in your house, you either got tears coming down your eyes, or you're standing up, Rudy, that's right. And you'd run through a brick wall right then, because you're like, I want to be that guy. I want to be unbroken. I don't care what I face, World War II. You put the log on my back and you keep mocking me and whipping me, but I'm going nowhere. We love this idea. It's just that we're not very good at it. Right? It's a great idea. It's just It's a lot easier to say and to think and watch a movie about than it is to actually get back up. One of the hardest moments in the history of the church, from my point of view, was when in the early church, there was a thing called the Donatist controversy. What happened in the early church was lots and lots of people were coming to faith in Jesus. So many that the Roman Empire itself was starting to be like more Christian. And so all of these people were coming to faith and they were getting baptized in local churches, and pastors were coming out of the woodwork to work in churches. Preaching faithful doctrine, doing like lots and lots of Christians. And then the emperor changed. It changed from an emperor who was friendly to Christianity to a guy named Diocletian. And Diocletian was not a good man. And he hated Christians. And he wanted to restore pagan worship throughout the empire. He actually thought the reason the empire wasn't doing well is because everybody stopped worshiping the other gods. So he punished the Christians with death. And in all these churches where you had all of these people coming into the faith, showing up to church, and even pastors, when they found out that this guy was after them, was going to kill them if they didn't pinch their little incense to the Caesar, they were like, I'm out. And they left. A few years later, Diocletian dies, and another emperor comes in, and he's great. So the pressure's off, and all the people who left, many of the people who left the church, including pastors and others, came back and were like, hey guys, what's going on? What'd I miss? And many of the people in the churches had lost brothers and had lost other pastors and had lost family members who were not willing to pinch the incense to Caesar. How you feel about those people coming back? You feel pretty good? While you're crying tears over your dead husband? Are you thinking to yourself, welcome back? So the controversy was, what do we do with these people? But it was one of the first moments in the history of the church where they had to ask the question, how do we help people persist? How do we help people persevere in faith? Because we're not guaranteed a future of happiness in this life. So how do you answer that question? How do you help people persist in faith? How do you help them be patient in affliction? Because the affliction actually is going to come. And the answer that Paul gives is the one that I've already talked about for a second. You have to focus on the joy to come. You will endure anything if the joy to come is great enough. If it fills your mind with glory and excitement, it doesn't matter what you go through in the present moment, because that's where I'm headed. I don't like flying in airplanes. I get claustrophobic, and for some unknown reason, I think they have a file on me. And they say, you know, let's put him in the back. You know where the toilet is? Just in front of that. I'm always in the back. I feel like I'm always in the back row. I fly with my friend. They put me on the window, and they're like, well, do you a favor. Put you on the window in the low ceiling. And there's always some 6'8" guy next to me who wants to talk, and he's leaning in because the engines are too loud. And so he's hovering in on me. There's a toilet behind me, and the guy, you can't recline, and the guy in front of you says, you know what, I'm sleepy, right back. So I'm like in my own tomb in the back. I want to shake the guy in front of me and go, do you realize that I can't go back at all? And if I did, I'd be literally on the toilet. Just go forward. I hate it. You wait in the line, and they're always mean to you about everything. Enjoy your flight. What are you talking about? I'm in a tomb. I'm in my own coffin. Why do we put up with it? Because the only way to get to Dallas without having to drive all those roads, which is worse, is to get on a plane. And you think, look, it's just only this little while. If I have to go to New Zealand, it's only going to be for this little while. And it's people say to me, how could you ever fly that 15-hour flight to New Zealand? It's just one day of your life, I say. It's just one day of your life. just present suffering. And it's not worth comparing with what's going to happen on the other end. That's why you go through with all of the inconvenience and all of the difficulty and all of the heartache. Look, if you got a flat tire on the way to the dentist, you're probably not going to continue. Oh, are you guys like the dentist, do you? Are you, oh boy, I want to go to the dentist. You wake up in the morning, you're like, I get stabbed in the face today. You know, what are you talking about? Of course not. If you get a flat tire on the way to the dentist, you're like, we can postpone. But if you get a flat tire on the way to getting your lottery winnings, you're like, nope, let's fix it. You know, don't worry about it. We'll figure it out. We'll get an Uber. We're going to get there. We'll keep going no matter what. If you love the woman enough, you will cross the rivers and the sea because the treasure is worth it. Don't you realize that you will endure suffering now to the degree that you delight in the joy awaiting then? Directly proportional. The amount of suffering you're willing, the amount of affliction that you're willing to deal with right now is directly proportional to how great the joy is then. How great is the joy then? You have a lot to look forward to. One of the greatest Christian women I have ever heard of is Johnny Erickson Tada. She is a quadriplegic. She was, since 1967, she actually dove into a lake and hit her head on a rock, and she's been a quadriplegic ever since. She paints with her mouth. She's living in a wheelchair, can't move her arms, legs. It's been like that for coming on 60 years. She was speaking actually at a conference a while ago, and here's what she said. She says, soon God will close the curtain on sin and suffering and disease and death, and we're gonna step into the Niagara Falls that will be. And one day I'm gonna leave this wheelchair behind. I can't wait. I may have suffered with Christ on earth, but one day in heaven I'm gonna reign with him. I may have tasted the pains of living on this planet, but one day I'm gonna eat from the tree of life in the pleasure of heaven, and it's all gonna happen in the twinkling of an eye. The Lord's overcoming of this world will be the lifting of the curtain on our five senses. And we shall see him, and we shall be like him, and we shall see the whole universe in plain sight. See, Romans 8:18 says that we can consider our suffering, present sufferings, not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed to us. But I sure hope I can bring this wheelchair to heaven. Now, I know that that's not theologically correct, but I hope to bring it, and I want to put it in a little corner of heaven, and then in my new, perfect, glorified body, standing on grateful, glorified legs, I'll stand next to my Savior, holding his nail-pierced hands, and I'll say, thank you, Jesus. And I'll say, Jesus, do you see that wheelchair? You were right when you said that in this world we'd have trouble, because that thing was a lot of trouble. But the weaker I was in that thing, the harder I leaned on you, and the harder I leaned on you, the stronger I discovered you to be. And it never would have happened had you not given me the bruising of the blessing of that wheelchair. And then the real ticker tape parade of praise will begin, and all of earth will join in the party. And at that point, Christ will open up our eyes to the great fountain of joy in his heart for us beyond all we've ever experienced on earth. And when we're able to stop laughing and crying, the Lord Jesus really will wipe away our tears. I find it so poignant that finally, at the point when I do have the use of my arms to wipe away my own tears, I won't have to, because God will. Amen. Persevere in affliction. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in affliction. Persist in prayer. Be persistent in prayer. Some of the great Christians of old, all right? Here's what they had to say about prayer. Martin Lloyd-Jones, probably the best 20th century preacher, said, everything we do in the Christian life is easier than prayer. Alexander White, a Scottish divine from the 19th century, said, "There's nothing that we are so bad at all our days as prayer." Thomas Shepard, a Puritan, he said, "There are times in my life when I'd rather die than pray." If you've ever sat down and tried your very hardest to pray and focus on prayer or even make it the continual act of your life through every circumstance and try to relate everything to the Lord, man, I'll tell you right now, you echo that. It is hard to pray. It's almost like there's someone trying to stop us. And yet you get commands throughout Scripture that you got to keep going, Colossians 4:2. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. Rejoice always. This is 1 Thessalonians 5:17. Rejoice always. Pray without ceasing. By the way, he doesn't mean that every single moment of every single day should be a prayer to God. What he's saying is don't give up. Don't ever stop. Be steadfast in it. Be persistent in it. Even Jesus tells a story, right, about a widow who goes to a judge and keeps demanding. Be like her. Keep knocking. Keep seeking. Keep asking. So look, let me finish our entire sermon series on prayer by just asking and answering the question, what will help us to persist in prayer? I have two pieces of advice, okay? Number one, you will persist in prayer if you realize you cannot live without the ever-present help of God. You cannot live without the ever-present help of God. You do see the connection between these phrases, right? So rejoice in hope, be patient in affliction, persistent in prayer. If you have this grand hope and you're rejoicing in it, the challenge is that you are going to be facing affliction in the present time. So you've got to keep persevering because you have this great promise at the end. But how do you actually do that? What does it look like to be patient in affliction? And the answer is, well, it's persistence in prayer. It's a constant conversation with the Lord, relating every affliction, every joy, every sorrow, and every happiness back to Him. It's every quiet moment an opportunity to speak to the Father who invites you in. And this relationship is supposed to basically be the fuel to your Christian life. If you don't do it, you will be driving your car on fumes. And eventually it will break down until you get more gas. The way God has instituted prayer in your life is it's basically the lifeline that is supposed to keep the oxygen going while you're under the water. If you cut it or saying, "I don't need it at all," you're done. I don't know if you've considered your situation very much. You probably have. In fact, it's probably the challenges that come to your mind repeatedly is because you do consider your situation. Some of you are raising children, babies. You have no idea what you're doing. None of us did. And if they're high schoolers, you really don't know what you're doing. Some of them are young adults, and you're trying to figure out how are they going to continue in life and maintain their marriages, and how are they going to keep following Jesus in this particular world, and will they have enough money, and will they have enough support, and you have no control over any of it. It plagues you and you worry about it all the time. Some of you are those kids and you're trying to figure out your future. Where do I go to college? Who do I marry? What kind of job do I want? And it plagues you in the quiet moments. You got to figure it out. Good luck. And you don't have any control over whether or not the university is going to accept you, or whether or not that boy or that girl is going to affirm you, or whether or not that job is going to want you. You can dress up, you can make your resume look amazing, but I don't know, how much control ultimately do you have about any of those things? And then when you get in the workplace, you're going to have to face the challenge of limited finances and all the HR trouble that will come your way. The hardest part about work is the other workers. And you will face all of these challenges. And you'll be like, I can't control the way they view me, how my boss understands me. I can't do any of this. And you'll feel completely alone. And you'll worry and fret on the side of your bed at night and wake up and stare at the ceiling and try to figure out, how do we drum up more business? Every aspect of your life is plagued with doubt and difficulty. If only there was one you could appeal to who could help. And the Lord says, hey, I'm right here. I'm right here. You know when the song comes up that says, Lord, I need you? You know this song? Even the Presbyterians are like, okay, I'll raise my hand on that one. That's all right. I mean, okay. Because it's something that touches our soul. We know it. Christian, you know it. You know you need the Lord. The degree to which you know you need the Lord is the degree to which you will pray. And the degree to which you will pray is the degree to which the lifeline will keep flowing and the rejoicing will happen. So look, you got to realize that you can't live without the ever-present help of God. But second, and I'll finish all of this with this, you have to remember that the affliction and all the things that I just described are how God invites you to talk. You have to understand that God has a special phone call for you. Do you know the little special phone, the ringtones? You can set those up. For my wife years ago, I had one from the Fine Young Cannibals. She drives me crazy. He drives me crazy. And as soon as it came on, I was like, that's my wife, right? And you answer the phone. What I'm telling you is that the Lord has a special ringtone. And the special ringtone that the Lord has in your life is affliction and anxiety. And you wonder why the anxiety is there. It's the Lord calling you saying, hey, I'd like to talk. I'd like actually to discuss with you why this is such a challenge. I want to know from you why your heart is so uneasy. I want to know from you what your hopes and your dreams are. I want to talk all the time. And so he sends phone calls throughout the day. You just need to answer. So Francis Fenelon, 17th century Roman Catholic archbishop, said this about prayer, and let it be the final words. Tell God all that is in your heart as one unloads one's heart, its pleasures and its pain, to a dear friend. Tell him your troubles. Tell him that he may comfort you. Tell him your joys, that he may sober them. Tell him your longings, that he may purify them. Tell him your dislikes, that he may help you to conquer them. Talk to him of your temptations, that he may shield you from them. Show him the wounds of your heart that he may heal them. Lay bare your indifference to good, your depraved tastes for evil, your instability. Tell him how self-love makes you unjust to others, how vanity tempts you to be insincere, how pride disguises you to yourself and others. If you pour out all your weaknesses, needs, and troubles in this way, there will be no lack of what to say. You will never exhaust the subject. It's continually being renewed. People who have no secrets from each other never want for subject of conversation. They don't weigh their words, for there's nothing to be held back. Neither do they seek for something to say. They talk out of the abundance of the heart without consideration. They say just what they think. Blessed are they who attain to such familiar, unreserved conversation with God. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in affliction. Be persistent in prayer. Let me pray. Father, if there is a possibility that a series of sermons can transform the lives of people, I pray that this is one of them. We can't live without you. We know it. Our pride tells us we can, but we can't. If we're honest, we desperately need you, and we desperately need to talk to you all the time. I pray, Lord, that the peace that passes all understanding would guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus as we lift every one of our cares up to you, for you care for us. So, Lord, I pray in the coming weeks and months and years that a spirit of dependence and prayer and love for you would be something that continues to grow amongst us. I pray that Harvest truly will live up to its pillars when we talk about unceasing prayer. And I pray, Lord, that you would bless us with that. So, Lord, we commit ourselves to you, and we commit ourselves to your grace, and ask, Lord, that you would now give us what it is that we ask, and that is more of you as we talk to you more. In Jesus' name, amen.
I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My
a good God, and we need him, and so we should be praying continually. Our hope and prayer is that this isn't just a sermon series for us, that this becomes a marker of our church, that we are a people of prayer. So I encourage you, keep praying, keep doing the things that we've been learning in this series. Maybe you've come today and you need prayer. I invite you to come forward. We'd love to pray over you. And we'll have some leaders down at the front that'd love to bear burdens with you and be able to partner with you in prayer. If you're new here, I'll be in the lobby. I would love to meet you, help you get connected here. Also, there's the Discover Harvest class. I'll be over in the Harvest Hope Center, and we'd love to be able to invite you to that class. It tells you what Harvest is about, and you can learn more about the church and ask questions. So if this is your first time, I invite you to that. Or even if you've been at the church for a while and have never really gotten plugged in, that's a great class for you as well. But as you go out on mission today, know that you are loved. Have a great week.